Thank you very much, Ajay, for your kind introduction. I'm sorry if I've taken a little time and kept some of you waiting, but that's my inability to deal with my electronic gadgets. Today, the topic that we have selected here is the independence of Election Commission. Some part of it on the paid news on the site, because that's a recent engaging topic. But independence of Election Commission is a serious issue because we wouldn't be a democracy if we really didn't have an independent Election Commission. So going back into a little bit of history, because we are on a webinar and can sometimes gets to be boring, I will try to build in a little bit history about how the Constituent Assembly debates took place and which to the extent even today are relevant, and some bit of the law laid down by the Supreme Court, and of course, everything based on the Constitution. So let's get going right away. You know, India has been constituted as a sovereign democratic republic. Now, our Constitution has been molded on principles which are contained in Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the ICCPR, CEDAW, and other human rights aspects. In this, to this extent, our preamble of the Constitution, I would say, is actually our guiding light to our basic structure of the Constitution. What do we say there? We say, we the people of India, having solemnly resolved to constitute India into a sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic, and to secure all its citizens, justice, social, economic, and political. So we can't forget the words that even our preamble uses. And then of course, liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith, and worship, equality of status and opportunity, and to promote fraternity. We have recognized the supremacy of our constitution, the republican and the democratic form of our government, its secular character, its separation of powers, federal characters. These are all our basic features of our constitution. Now, therefore, I'm going to limit myself to democratic form of the government, which consequently is all dependent upon the independence of our Election Commission. When it comes to establishing a democratic polity, the bedrock thereof is a free and fair election. Now, Election Commission has been established for conduct of these elections and to protect the democratic setup. The Election Commission is not only required to be an independent body, but also it's fiercely protected from any form of intrusion into discharge of its functions, be those functions be its executive, those bodies which may intrude into it may be executive, the legislature, or for that matter, the judiciary itself. And that's the scheme of the Constitution. Therefore, to begin with, you would be surprised that our entire Election Commission or the part of our democratic setup is just confined in part 15, and which itself comprises only of about six articles, Article 324 and to Article 329. The relevant for our talk today will be 324 and 329 primarily. Now, Article 324 provides that the superintendents, direction, control of preparation of the electoral rolls, conduct of all the elections to the parliament, to the state legislative assemblies, to the president and vice presidents will be vested in the Election Commission. It also says that the Election Commission will be comprised of the chief election commissioner and the other election commissioners, as the president may from time to time fix and appoint. Now, that's another part of it, which we will deal with the independence of the Election Commission. Now, 324 actually insulates also, and it's a protective measure on independence of Election Commission. And it says that the service and the tenure of the office of the election commissioners are protected. For example, the chief election commissioner's tenure is protected to the extent that he shall continue in his office and he shall not be removed from his office, save and except in the manner just like as a judge of the Supreme Court. And his conditions of service will not be varied. Now, so far as the election commissioners are concerned, they cannot be removed from the office. except on a recommendation made by the Chief Election Commissioner. So this is basically the structure that we are now discussing on. Article 327 then prescribes the power of the Parliament to make provisions with respect to elections to the legislations. And there, that is the power under which our Representation of People's Act has been framed, that is Act of 1950 and 1951. Then we come to 329. 329 is a very important article. It starts with the non-obstanta clause, and it says, notwithstanding anything contained in this constitution, the validity of any law relating to the delimitation of constituencies shall not be called in question before the court. Now, delimitation is one aspect, and the second limb says, no election to either House of Parliament or to the House of Legislature of the state shall be called in question except by an election petition presented to such authority in such manner as may be provided by law that may be made. Now, that also goes under the Representation of People's Act. So, therefore, in the conduct of elections, the Election Commission is completely insulated. While it's conducting its election, its directions, its orders cannot be brought into challenge at any time. Now, that is Article 329 for us. These articles were subject matter of intense debates before the Constituent Assembly at the time when our this thing was being framed. Now, if we go through the Constituent Assembly debate, it reveals one thing, that there was a unanimous agreement amongst all the members of the Constituent Assembly that there was a need to hold free and fair elections, and there was a complete need for an independent body which would then hold these particular elections, which body is free from executive control and influence. So they were very categorical in Constituent Assembly debates that there has to be no executive control or influence on this particular body which is going to conduct the election. Dr. Ambedkar, in his speech, had some very interesting phrases. There's some of them which are very important and actually very relevant even today. So I might just read out, but I'll try and keep them brief. Ambedkar said, in the interest of purity and freedom of election to legislative bodies, it was of utmost importance that they be freed from any kind of interference from executive of the day. It is true even today. There is no change in that status even today. In fact, initially, the committee, which was the Constituent Committee engaged in framing of the Constitution, the Committee on Fundamental Rights wanted to include the independence of election and avoidance of any interference by the executive as a fundamental right itself in the chapter of fundamental rights. But subsequently, this initial idea to keep it in Chapter 3 was dropped. And Ambedkar then in those Constituent Assembly debates said this, when the matter came up before the House, it was the wish of the House that while there was no objection to regard this matter as of fundamental importance, so fundamental importance, it should be provided for in some other part of the Constitution and not in the chapter dealing with fundamental rights. That is how we got the six articles in Part 15, which deal with something so significant as our very democracy, our existence as a democracy itself. Therefore, Article 324, which was originally designed as Article 289, came to be drafted. A significant portion of the debate before the Constituent Assembly was whether there should be a separate election commission for the center and there should be a separate election commission for the provinces and the state. Finally, to maintain a balance between the two, they decided to have a Central Election Commission, which is your Election Commission of India today, and which would have regional commissioners under its control. Now, the words of the Constituent Assembly, why it was so vexed on the issue, whether to have a central commission or to have one in the provinces, and finally took a decision to have a Central Election Commission, is reflected in these few lines, which the Constituent Assembly debates will reflect, and which is relevant even today. It said, in these provinces, which is the states, if they had to have their own commission, in these provinces, the executive government is instructing or managing things in such manner that those people who do not belong to them, either racially, culturally, or linguistically, are excluded from being brought on the electoral rolls. So the apprehension at that time was that those local bodies were conducting themselves in a manner that if they did not find people who match them racially, culturally, or if they remove them from the electoral rolls, they would have no representation. The House will realize that franchise is the most fundamental thing in a democracy. No person who's entitled to be brought into electoral rolls on the ground, which have already been mentioned in our constitution, namely an adult, that time 21 years of age, now amended to 18 of age, should be excluded merely as a result of a prejudice of a local government or a whim of an officer. So a central election commission with regional commissioners, so as to ensure that no regional areas would influence the creation of independent electoral rolls, which would have everybody in the name, whoever was eligible to vote, should be enrolled, which is adult, universal adult suffrage primarily. Now I come to the first limb. I have divided this independence of election commission and its propositions into two main, and the third one is a slightly smaller. One is judiciary and election commission, and the second thing is the constitution of the very election commission itself, the protection of a tenure of the election commissioners, and some of the judgments that came there from T.N. Session, many of you may remember, who was one who was very instrumental in giving us a lot of our laws. So we will deal with some of that in the form of how the assembly wanted to create an independent body there. The first part of it, which was judicial intervention with the functioning of an election commission, particularly when there is a conduct of elections. Now, the Supreme Court has very zealously protected the independence of our election commission from its pronouncements beginning as early as 1951. Election Commission was set up on 25th January 1950, but its very independence as such came to be questioned in November of 1951 itself, so merely a year and a half later. Now, this is the very well-celebrated case, and many of you would know about it or may have even heard about it, which is the N.P. Punnoswamy case, the earliest judgment on independence of functioning of an election commission. Punnoswamy was contesting election from Madras Legislative Assembly from a constituency called the Namakkal constituency in Salem. He filed his nomination papers. His nomination papers came to be rejected by the returning officer. He challenged the rejection of his nomination papers under Article 226 before the Madras High Court. The Madras High Court rejected his petition, said, hands off. Article 329 is a complete bar. I cannot interfere with the election process. He came to the Supreme Court, and that is the reported judgment, which is N.P. Punnoswamy versus the returning officer, 1952 SCR 218. Now, Supreme Court, in its effectively its very first judgment on this independence, says, now this is the reasoning that Supreme Court adopted, that is almost 67 years back, having importance to the functions which the legislatures have to perform. The legislatures have to perform. In democratic countries, it has always been recognized to be a matter of first importance that elections should be concluded as early as possible according to time schedule, and all controversial matters and disputes arising out of the elections will be postponed till after the elections are over, so that election proceedings may not be unduly retarded or protracted. So the fundamental basis, hands off, legislative assembly has to be constituted. You have any challenges, they will come later on, but the election proceedings must not be retarded or protected. Till date, 67 years later, the courts in this country have refrained from interfering in the election process once the election process has commenced. Any dispute with respect to of an election is decided in an election petition, which is provided for in the Representations of People Act 1951. But while the elections are on, the courts have rigorously and unfailingly applied a hands-off principle and to any interference with the conduct of the elections. Now, while we are speaking about Punnuswamy, I would be really amiss if I do not mention another significant aspect that this judgment decided, which may not be a subject matter of the topic today, but it is very significant, and this judgment is cited for these two particular propositions of law, and which is that the right to vote or to stand is not a civil right, but it is a creature of a statute or a special law and must be subject to limitations imposed by it. So all the rights to contest, to either whether to vote or to contest an election, is subject to the limitations of representation of people. So therefore, it's a statutory right and has to be controlled. Now, after Punnuswamy, in 1978, is the next watershed moment when the independence of Election Commission came to be questioned. This was in the so-called Mohinder Singh Gill's case. The Election Commission in this case, there was elections which were being done for 13th Firozpur constituency in Punjab. At the time of counting of the votes, so the election process was over, it was almost the last few hours of counting of the votes, there was a mob violence. An election commission completely countermanded the election itself. It actually cancelled the entire whole poll of the constituency and directed fresh elections to be held. Mohinder Singh Gill was naturally aggrieved because he was leading by a considerable margin and was likely to win that particular election. So he made a representation to the election commission not to reconsider his decision to countermand the complete election itself, to cancel the election. The election commission did not accede to his representation. He filed a 226. The High Court also did not accede, saying that we cannot interfere with the decision. While the matter was so pending, fresh election was held and Mohinder Singh lost in that particular election. His opponent won the election, but he nevertheless came against the judgment of the High Court to the Supreme Court. In the Supreme Court, now this judgment becomes very important because it formulates the issue very well and it holds the blanket field even till date from 1978 onwards. The Supreme Court formulated two issues, but the first issue is very, very important. And Justice Krishna Iyer's judgment is even more important there. It said, is Article 329B a blanket ban on all manners of question which may have impact on the ultimate result of an election between two temporal termini, that is, the notification of holding the election by the president and till the date of the result. So those are the two temporal termini. So will there be a blanket ban on any kind of a question that you may have between these two particular points? Now, this was a very important question. And the second issue that the court considered was, can an election commission, which is clothed with comprehensive functions under Article 324, cancel the whole poll of a constituency after it has been held and direct a fresh reference? So this is what was, you know, very interesting. Justice Krishna Iyer, speaking for himself, for Justice Bhagwati and Justice Beg, after a very detailed discussion, held, and this is what he says, it is a blanket ban on litigative challenges to electoral steps taken by the commission for carrying forward for the process of election right up to formal declaration of results. So Justice Krishna Iyer clearly said that it is a blanket ban. There can be no litigative challenges till the declaration of the result. But what is important is that while deciding that it is a blanket ban, he relies upon the maxim of ubi jus ibi remedium, where there is a wrong, there is a remedy. So you would say, how is that? Because there is a wrong that has happened, I am not getting the remedy because the court says I will not interfere. So this he says that to hold that the powers of a commission under the 1951 Act were large enough to give relief to an aggrieved candidate to undo any illegality and injustice and to do complete justice within the parameters of a law. That is, 1951 Act provides that if you want to challenge the electoral process, you will do it only in an election petition. So he says, you have a remedy. You have a remedy in law, but your remedy is deferred. Your remedy is deferred till the election is over. After the election is over, your remedy lies in an election petition. By all means, challenge it now. But between those two temporal termini, as it is said, that is the notification of the president till the declaration of result. Sorry, no challenge. This was a very, very significant judgment, but it is also very, very important for one more aspect. And that's something which is very close to my heart, and I tend to cite it very often. And I think it's quite nice, and I would like to share it with you. Justice Krishna Iyer, on the principles of democracy, because we are talking now about putting a legislative assembly or a parliament in position, so there can be no delay to holding of an election, took this little passage from Winston Churchill and then put his little bit own into it and made one of the most beautiful passages in this judgment, which is very often cited. And this is what he says. The message, as we will see at the end of the decision, relates to pervasive philosophy of democratic elections, which Sir Winston Churchill vivified in matchless words. Now, this is what Winston Churchill had said, and it's very significant for a democracy, which is, at the bottom of all tributes paid to democracy is a little man walking into a little booth with a little pencil, making a little cross on a piece of paper. So that's democracy, a little man walking into a little booth with a little pencil, making a little cross on a little paper. No amount of rhetoric or voluminous discussion can possibly diminish the overwhelming importance of the point. To this, Justice Krishna Iyer added, if we may add, the little large Indian shall not be hijacked from the course of free and fair elections by mob muscle method, subtle perversion of discretion by men dressed in little brief authority. For be you ever so high, the law is above you. So these last three sentences that Justice Krishna Iyer added to Sir Winston Churchill's quote leaves us with so much till day. For example, at the time when Justice Krishna Iyer wrote this judgment, we did not have the EVMs. Elections were held through the method of actual polling, our voting. You know, we would cast in our little ballot papers into that box. And very often there would be hijacking of the poll booths. There would be the ballot boxes would be taken away and they would be done. And but mind you, that was one aspect of hijacking by mob muscle methods. But please read the second part. Subtle perversion of discretion by men dressed in little brief authority. So those people in position of power who are dressed in that authority, even they cannot hijack our democracy. We will not allow that. So you are not so high that the law is still above you. Now, that was what Justice Krishna Iyer said. He has another very lovely paragraph I will leave you to read. I'm not going to read it because I can see I started a little late and I seem to be running a little short on the time. Paragraph 23 is pretty relevant. Please read it at your leisure. And also please read TN Station on democratic principle. It will give you some very interesting reading. Coming quickly, since I have to cover a fair bit of ground, this particular declaration of law that the court or judiciary will have a hands-off principle and will not interfere in the matters of election after the commencement till the result underwent some dilution. The first dilution came in the year 2000 in the judgment of Election Commission of India versus Ashok Kumar and others. Here, the Supreme Court struck down an order of a Kerala High Court directing that the counting of the votes would be done station-wise and not by mixing the ballot papers. This was in respect of Alappuzha parliamentary constituencies. Now, that was a very important facet because normally you can never count the votes polling booth-wise. I'm deviating. I just want to tell you why. if you take the polls which is taken booth-wise, in a constituency, you will have maybe 50 booths, let us say. So the party who will lose the election or that he will win the election will know that in that particular booth, people voted against me. There can be always a propensity to then act against those people who have voted against the party that comes into power. And it intrudes into the privacy of a right of a voter. So what the Supreme Court did was completely right. But it had to explain why it exercised that power at the time when the election process had already commenced, which it ordinarily could not have done under Article 329B. The Supreme Court said, and it carved out these two exceptions, that why you can interfere under 329B, and it said, if the decision that is sought and rendered will not amount to calling into question an election, if it subserves the progress of the election and facilitates the completion of an election. So if the order of a court enables the completion of an election, it will not be detrimental. You can go that far. But the second is very important. Then the court says judicial intervention can be to smoothen the progress of the election proceedings and so as to see that to remove any obstacles, preserve a vital piece of evidence which may not be lost or destroyed or rendered irretrievable by the time a result is declared. So the basic underlying principle, you come in the aid of furtherance of an election, you may interfere, but you will not interfere which will have anything to retard the election or which would result in preventing the election to proceed. Now this principle was subsequently again upheld in Manda Jagannath, which is a 2004 judgment, the same principle. So we have these two judgments which went slightly against that Punnu Swami and Mohinder Singh Gill, which occupied the field for a very long time. Now, very, very quickly, the Constitution envisaged that the powers of the Election Commission were plenary in nature and were subject to whatever be the law that would be made by the Parliament. So after the Constitution came, the Parliament came out with two legislations. One is the Representation of People's Act 1950, which provides for allocation of seats, delimitation of constituencies, that's the House of People and the state bodies, and qualification of voters. Then comes the Representation of People's Act 1951, which is the actual conduct of the election, qualification, disqualification of members, corrupt illegal practices, election offenses, election disputes, petitions, etc. So these were the two legislations. Now the broad principle that the court has held on to this is, power of the Election Commission under Article 324 is plenary. It of course is subject to RP Act, but where the RP Act does not provide for it, Election Commission can give directions and those directions get to be followed. They are like providing in where the statute may not provide so. The very first issue in this that came up in a challenge was in the case of Lakshmi Charan Sen, where it was said that the Election Commission has given certain directions. These directions, will they have a force of law if those directions are not complied with? Because after all, there is no legislative power in the Election Commission or no power under the statute to give the direction. So what is the effect of that? So what the court held, that the commission is entitled to issue the direction to election authorities. These directions are binding on all the election authorities. They have to follow with this. But a third party cannot derive any rights or complain that that election is vitiated because somebody did not follow the direction. Simple example. If Election Commission directed the state bodies or its regional officers, call all the political parties before you, hold a meeting and take a decision on that particular point. Now, the regional commissioner probably did not follow the direction of the Chief Election Commission in Delhi. It cannot be a ground to countermand or to set aside an election. So that right is not there, but yes, its directions are required to be followed. After this, simultaneously came the most important judgment came in Kanhaiya Lal Omar. Election Commission went and framed what is called the Election Symbols Reservation and Allotment Order 1968. Now, nowhere in the statute under the RP Act or anywhere there would be such a power to frame such an order. This is primarily a compendium of directions to meet with various situations while conducting elections. The constitutional validity came to be challenged. The Supreme Court upheld the constitutional validity of the election symbols reservation order on the principle that symbol orders were not legislative in character. This was the challenge which was done, and they could not have been issued by the Election Commission. But they said under Article 324, the Commission has plenary powers, has the power of superintendence, direction, control of all elections. And therefore, it could have issued these particular guidelines for the conduct of elections where otherwise there was no other material that was available. There is another judgment that comes later on, which is Rooplal Sethi, but I will not go into it given our time, because I would like to very quickly now deal with the second one, which has two very significant judgments of Dhanoa and Sheshan and some Constituent Assembly debates, which is on the composition and functioning of the Commission itself. Now, in the scheme of things, Election Commission was expected to be an independent body. There should be no interference by either electoral, legislative, or judiciary. Therefore, it was first comprised only that of a chief election commissioner and such other commissioners as the president may appoint from time to time. So, single member body, not to have a large body, because it's going to function only during the time of elections. For the remaining 4.5 years, it has not much to do. But the entire state machinery is given at its disposal at the time of the election, and it has the right to pass such directions to any officer of the center or the state government during the course of election. Now, at the time of drafting of this constitution, there was a huge debate whether you have a permanent body of 4 or 5 members or an ad hoc body which may be appointed by a president when the elections were going to be conducted. K.M. Munshi had a very interesting statement on this, but this was not, it was modified later on. And he said this: we cannot have an election commission sitting all the time during the 5 years doing nothing. Chief election commissioner will continue as a whole-time officer performing the duties of this office, looking after the works. Only when the elections take place in the country, provincial or central commission may be enlarged. And there was no doubt to be appointed by the president. Now, the Constituent Assembly took a middle ground. They said, we will appoint Chief Election Commission as a permanent member. The rest can come, keep coming later on. But then came the point is where the vesting of a power, who is to be given the power of appointing of the Chief Election Commissioner and the commissioners? Because whoever will appoint this person, this body has to be independent. The person has to be independent. If the elections have to be committed free and fairly, the office of the Chief Election Commissioner or the Election Commission has to be completely independent. Please see now at that point how the discussion took place. They said the possibility that the president could also be prone to appointing a biased Chief Election Commissioner, as the president himself is the party man and could have his own bias and prejudices, and the president being bound by the advice of the prime minister and council of ministers could be forced to appoint a biased CEC, was intensely, this was a serious issue of debate, that you are leaving the power to a president, he's advised by the prime minister, he's also a party man, so how are you going to have this free single appointment? Ambedkar admitted in those debates, he said, there is no use in making a tenure of the election commission as a fixed and a secure tenure if there is no provision in the constitution to prevent either a fool or a knave or a person who is likely to be under the thumb of the executive. I do not want to confess that this is a very important question and it has given me a great deal of headache. I have no doubt about that it is going to give the house a great deal of headache. So you see, creating that independence of an election appointed chief election commissioner was a very serious issue. There were certain suggestions that came. There were two suggestions which were very significant. One was Shibanlal Saxena in those debates. And he said, every person who's appointed originally should be such that he should enjoy the confidence of all the parties. So what he said was that you take the two-third majority of both the houses of legislature and then appoint the chief election commissioner. This idea was shot down. They said it'll get vexed in the parliament. We will never be able to have it. So therefore, there was a second suggestion which was introduced by Pandit Hridaynath Kunzru, which B.R. Ambedkar accepted. And this was that the chief election commissioner would be appointed subject to the approval of the parliament. This would be a dilatory process. So therefore, instead of doing so, you would appoint the chief election commission and other commissioners subject to provisions of any law made by the parliament. So they left it to the law made by the parliament. Now look how intense that debate was to have an independent one. But in your final scheme of Article 324, it was said this is too much of a headache. Let the parliament make a legislation and they will decide how the CEC is to be appointed. Then came the Goswami Committee on Electoral Reforms. Looking at my time, I'm not going to go into it. Finally, what you have today is that under Article 324.5, now this is the protection that we gave to the Election Commission. We appoint him, the president appoints the election commissioner. Normally, these are the senior civil officers who are being appointed. But the chief election commissioner has got his security of tenure, 6 years or 65 years of age, whichever is earlier. Now, his removal is only like that of a Supreme Court judge. So therefore, he cannot be removed easily from the office. The minute he cannot be removed easily from office, he has that power to take independent decisions occupying the office of a chief election commissioner. Leaving the rest, I will very quickly come down. The power was given to president to appoint such number of election commissioners in addition to CEC. The appointment of the other election commissioners is done by the president, but their removal is upon a recommendation made by the chief election commissioner. So they cannot be just removed like that. The chief election commissioner has to give a recommendation for their removal. The president appointed two election commissioners. That was one Mr. Dhanowa and one more gentleman whose name I'm forgetting just now. Then he suddenly abolished those positions. So Dhanowa went and challenged the abolition of the position of an election commission. Mind you, he was not the chief election commissioner. He was only an election commissioner. So he said, you cannot remove me. I have the same security as the election chief election commissioner has. And therefore, I'm entitled to protection. The court in that particular judgment held that the Noah's removal was by abolition of post. So it was not a termination of the post. So they did not interfere with that abolition. And he said the framers of a constitution did not intend to give the election commissioner the same status as a chief election commissioner. Why I'm saying this? Because this will undergo a change in session subsequently. So they treated the election commissioners as being slightly lower down in the hierarchy, protection, and chief election commissioner was the first among the equals. That was the kind of a status which came about in a Dhanowa's judgment. Now, in the meantime, because the government had not framed this procedure, then came, there was Goswami Committee report, then came the Election Commission Conditions of Service, Election Commissioners Transaction of Business Act 1991. Now, in this, the procedure was set out for the appointment and it provided for a multi-member committee. And now there was a dilution. So the election commissioners did have some more powers than they did under the Dhanowa judgment. For example, an election commission would take a unanimous decision. In Dhanowa, it said no, chief election commissioner could override. But now they said they would take a unanimous decision. The business shall be as far as possible done unanimously. If they do not unanimously agree, then you will do it by a majority. So Seshan, who was the CEC at that time, he challenged. He went to the court and he said, I am the CEC. Dhanowa gave me all the powers and said that I take the final decision. You have now brought in two election commissioners, which was M.S. Gill and C.V.J. Krishnamurti, and you have diluted all my powers. So now I can't take a decision if it is not unanimous. It will be by majority. There are two of them. So my power of majority is gone. By a very significant judgment in tea and session. In fact, the observations made in that are very, very important. I'll just read very briefly and I'll conclude this part here. And in 5 minutes, I will finish with paid news with you. The court then held that it is important that the entire power should not be vested in just one person. The position of an election commission is so significant that it is important that the power is shared and that decisions are taken unanimously, because after all, it deals with the entire procedure in this country. And this is what the court said. Recommendation for removal must be based now. The power that was that if you want to remove an election commissioner, then the chief election commissioner can only have to say, I recommend you remove the election commissioner. So the power with chief election commissioner, that's a part of the constitution, was wide, and Session could have exercised that and said, remove Gill, remove Krishnamurthy. So what did the Supreme Court say? He protected the election commissioners. He said, recommendation of a removal must be based on intelligible and cogent considerations, which would have a relation to efficient functioning of election commission. That is because a privilege has been conferred on CEC to ensure that election commissioner, as well as the regional commissioners, are not at the mercy of the political or executive bosses of the day. It is necessary to realize that this check on the executive power to remove inbuilt into the second proviso of Clause 5 to safeguard the body. So the court said, please exercise your power to recommend removal of an election commission judicially, not with an intelligible basis, because you are protecting your body and your authority from the executive, from the legislatures, and from the others. I'm not getting into the rest because it's rather long. And since then, we have a 3-member election commission. Now, there is no qualification for being an election commissioner. So there was a challenge before the Supreme Court in Bhagwati Prasad, that Ghodewala, who used to challenge all of the elections. He said that if you say the removal of the chief election commissioner is like that of a Supreme Court judge, why should his qualifications not be that of a Supreme Court judge? The Supreme Court very cursorily turned that down. After that, we have had no provisions which talks about challenge. The rest of the provisions is on the election machinery, etc. I think I'm going to leave it for today. Maybe we'll have another opportunity. And just give me 2 minutes to deal with the paid news part of it. What is a paid news? At the time of elections, this is in 2009, it was found by Press Council that there were identical articles with photographs, identical articles, and together with headlines, appearing in different newspaper publications, purportedly by different authors. Now, they're identical. They're verbatim identical. Different newspapers, different authors, and similar page praising one competing candidate and saying that he's likely to win. Or sometimes the same newspaper in the same column or a page carried articles. On one day it said this will win. Other day he said the other competing will win. So, and these were all said to be news articles. It was found that these articles were in fact more in the nature of a paid news. Two specific cases came up before the Supreme Court. One was in the case of Madhu Khoda and other was in case of Umlesh Yadav. Now, as you know, that if you have not disclosed your expenses, that can be a matter before under Section 10A of the Representation People's Act. If your expenses or accounts are not all right, the election commission can disqualify you for a period of 3 years. But in an election petition, the person who's challenging your election can only challenge with whatever material he has. In Madhu Khoda, election was held, election petitions over, nothing happened. Much later, the income tax authority raided him. During the course of raid, they found some receipts which showed about 6 crores by way of election advertisement expenditure, which was incurred during the time of the election. This led to a complaint before the election commission under Section 10A. And then the election commission said, you have violated the procedure for declaration of your accounts under the conduct of election rules. You have not given the correct account. We exercise our powers under 10A and you are disqualified for 3 years. Similar thing happened in Umlesh Yadav. In Umlesh Yadav, two different newspapers carried identical articles, not one, but more than one newspapers, purportedly as a news, but actually they were advertisements and they were funded by her husband. Now, those matters went to Election Commission. Election Commission forwarded them to Press Council of India. Action was taken against the media houses. The Supreme Court in Ashok Chauhan's case held that Election Commission has the power under Section 10A to look into these accounts and then to disqualify those persons for a period of 3 years. So your election, if it is found that you have actually indulged in paid news, your elections can go away. You can lose your election. You can be disqualified for a period of 3 years. But paid news is a very serious issue that is being faced across board, because newspaper, unfortunately, I would say there are 5 pillars to a democracy: the legislature, the executive, the judiciary, the election commission, the independence of which is very important, and the media. Now, if any one of them actually topples, it does affect your quality, the quality of your democracy, and everything here. Paid news is a very big issue because it does not allow the elector to make an unbiased or an uninfluenced decision. Paid news results in influencing the decision of an elector in not a right manner. Or it kind of brainwashes an electors, makes them believe certain things, creates a herd voting pattern. Now, therefore, paid news has become a significant issue. Maybe on another time, we'll have more time, we'll discuss some of these issues, maybe in more detail. I'm sorry if I've taken a little bit longer than my proposed time and for starting late. But thank you so much if you have been able to sit through this 45, 50 minutes of this talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Meenakshi ma'am. And in fact, it has been wonderful learning experience, especially on part 15 of the Constitution of India. I mean, with elaborately you have discussed about the independence and the paid news. Now, I request participants, if they would like to have some queries and questions, you may unmute your mic and enable your video and you can ask the question directly.
Sir, good evening, ma'am. Good evening, sir. Sir, can I ask one question, sir?
Yeah. Sure, Shobhit, go ahead.
Ma'am, in respect of the in this webinar, we have learned that election symbol and reservation order 1968. What was the process earlier? How it was the election symbol used to be granted to the candidate?
There was no method previously. I think that is why they brought in the symbols order, and they had they probably followed the same procedure prior thereto, that is having the recognized registered parties. Now, recognized parties are the ones which will have to meet with certain qualifications. So I think problem that they had prior thereto was that they had not this qualification criteria or the yardsticks prior thereto. But they followed more or less a procedure in the same lines. So this they kind of codified it into the form of an order, whatever they had earlier given by way of instructions. Previously, Election Commission used to give instructions and directions, and they put it in a form of a codified order in 68. And mind you, there were not so many elections or disputes prior thereto. Most symbol dispute came later on with that Congress, Janata Dal and everything. Came later after this.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Yeah.
I just want to ask, ma'am, in generalized statement, when we a lot of candidates do speak like generalized statement that we don't get booth vote from that booth. So in general, that what we explained that in respect of the voting scenario. Sometimes we do generalized statement. I'll tell you,
there is a judgment of the Supreme Court which upheld the inclusion of nota on an EVM, which is none of the above. That came on the very same principle that if you allow the returned party or the people who are contesting to know in what trend the election has gone from a particular booth. The chance of retaliation against the electors is very high. So therefore, particularly in villages and remote areas, therefore, there is very important to protect the privacy of the electors as for whom they have cast their vote, so that there is no retaliation and muscle power used later on. So when the EVM came, that protection was not available. When they had ballot paper, they used to write, sab chor hai, kisi ko vote nahi dena hai. So they used to come out and nobody would be wiser. But when EVM came, they had to vote because there was no ballot, which was the nota. The nota came in by the Supreme Court judgment.
Okay.
So that is why it's very important that you don't disclose from which poll booth, who, whether, how the people have, you know, what has been a trend in a particular.
Trend, actually. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, what is a particular trend? You don't want to disclose that to the party.
So it's a general question. I just want to ask, ma'am. Ma'am, how much this social media platforms like Facebook and Twitter plays the important role during the elections, that what you have highlighted, that these platforms like social
media. That's true. That's true. When you try to create, I think, therefore, the informed decision of an elector is very important. That is where the judgment of ADR and PUCL comes in. Please understand that in 2005 and 2002, when the PUCL and the ADR judgment came, the principle was that a voter has to have an informed choice. He must know his candidate. He must know whether there are criminal background, what is his assets, etc. So the Supreme Court directed the Election Commission that in future, this is a compulsory disclosure for every candidate. I'm coming to your point of social media, just to this aspect.
Okay, ma'am.
So there was an informed decision.
You highlighted the social media, ma'am. So that's why, sorry to interrupt, ma'am, that you highlighted the social media. That's why I asked during the webinar.
Yeah, but you know, when in social media, you create a lot of information, you know, you bombard an information virtually, creating a kind of a direction or a herd mindset towards a particular thing. It's very important that in an election, an elector has an informed choice. That informed choice is actually more from actually what the candidate gives a disclosure in his nomination forms. And I think it's very important to educate an elector rather than to get bombarded by either a Facebook, social media, or for that matter, by a paid news. Therefore, the disclosure of a candidate about his antecedents, which is now compulsory, and by under the law, by because of the judgments of the Supreme Court, I think is one of the most important disclosures. And probably there's a need to educate an elector to look into that rather than to look into the other aspects.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. I think the question of Gunjan, which she wanted to ask, is how can paid news be checked when some media houses are owned by politicians?
Gunjan, I couldn't disagree more on that. I mean, I'm completely one with you. And the only thing that is why I said that it's a very important pillar of democracy to have an independent media. And I think on that aspect, there's a responsibility will lie on us as electors and to educate ourselves to look at the antecedents, as I said just now, of a candidate, because his nomination form is going to be accompanied by a affidavit, which gives a disclosure if he has any criminal cases pending against him, what is his net worth, what are his assets, how much he has made between last election and this election. And I'm going to end it with one sentence. In Manipur, if I'm not mistaken, one of the candidates wrote his qualification false declaration in that nomination form. He said he had a particular degree, which actually he didn't have. His election got set aside because of a false disclosure of his educational qualification. I would say to everyone, that's a huge tool that you have in your hand. Election Commission is obliged to upload it. You will be able to see it on their site. Please go ahead and see it, compare it, and use that information for purpose of elect and educate others rather than to get driven by, you know, people trying to tell you, or then read 10 newspapers and see at least 4 or 5 media sites to be sure about who you are voting for.
Thank you, Meenakshi ma'am. I'm thankful to everyone and Meenakshi ma'am. With this, I think we'll be concluding our session. No more questions. I'm also thankful to Bar Council of Delhi, again, and International Bridges to Justice India for organizing this session. This will be a recorded session and will be uploaded on YouTube also, so that the other who could not attend the session will be able to enjoy. We'll be coming again with the next week with some more interesting sessions. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Meenakshi ma'am, again. Thank you so much for your
time. Thank you, Ajay.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Ajay, for having me.